In Polish, there are 7 grammatical cases, and dative, or in Polish, celownik, is one of them. Hello everyone, I'm Monika and welcome to my channel Learn Polish with Monika. In today's lesson, I will tell you about the dative case in Polish. I will tell you when do we use the dative case and how to build words in this case. First, let's have a look, when do we use this dative case? What is the function? What is it for? In order to understand what for do we use this case, maybe it's good to have a look first at the name of this case in Polish. This will help us understand what is it for. Dative in Polish is celownik. Celownik. And in the word celownik, we can see the part cel, cel. And this word actually means a goal, an aim, a target. And yes, this will be often the case that celownik, the dative case, is showing us the target, the goal of an action in the sentence. Because cases show us what is the function of a word in a sentence. And the dative shows us that a certain part of the sentence is the target. But let's look deeper into that and see examples so you can see what I mean. So as mentioned, this dative case is used when we want to show the target of an action. This shows us who's the receiver or addressee of an action. In English, very often we will use prepositions like to or for. This is for somebody, this is to somebody. And in an example, dałam synowi książkę. I gave a book to my son. We can see the word synowi in red, and this is the dative case. Dałam synowi książkę. Dałam synowi książkę. Synowi, to my son. He is, the son, is the receiver. In this case, he's receiving the book. I am the subject. Ja dałam. To whom? Synowi, to my son, to the son. Right? So you can see that thanks to this case, we can see that the son, my son, is the receiver. We can see the difference between the subject, who gave the book, and who received. Or another example, on przyniósł mi kawę. He brought me some coffee. On przyniósł mi kawę. On przyniósł mi kawę. He brought me some coffee. This time the receiver is me. Brought me. I received the coffee. And in Polish, the word me shows that. That's the word in the dative case. Or ona pokazała zdjęcia koleżance. She showed the photos to her friend. Ona pokazała zdjęcia koleżance. Ona pokazała zdjęcia koleżance. And here, koleżance is the word in the dative case. So the friend received the photos. Actually, just to see them, not maybe to own them, but she's the receiver of this action. One person showed, the other saw. So the person who saw the pictures is in the dative case. Yeah? So thanks to this case, we can observe who's the subject and who's the receiver. And one more. Kupiłam dziecku nowe buty. I bought new shoes for my child. Kupiłam dziecku nowe buty. Kupiłam dziecku nowe buty. So dziecku, to my child, for my child, that's the word in the dative case. The receiver. Right? So we use the dative case when we have a receiver. Sometimes we also use the dative case after certain verbs. You can sometimes see the receiver, but sometimes it's not so clear. Then the verb will give you a hint that now it's time for the dative case. For example, after dziękować, to thank somebody, we will use the dative case. Maybe the receiver of the thank you will be. That's how you can translate that. Or after the verb pomagać, to help. After podobać się, to be attracted to. Przyglądać się, to look closely to something. Zabraniać, to forbid. Ufać, to trust. Or powiedzieć, to tell. Sometimes it is easy to visualize that there is a receiver of this action. Sometimes maybe it's quite vague. Let's see some examples. Pomóż mi. Help me. Pomóż mi. Pomóż mi. Here, who's the receiver of this action? It's me. I'm receiving help. So you can maybe think this way, that sometimes it's maybe not so clear if this is a receiver or not, but in a way you can see that. But the verb might help you with that. Pomóż mi. Help me. Nie ufam nikomu. I don't trust anyone. Nie ufam nikomu. Nie ufam nikomu. Yeah, this time nikomu is in the dative case. Maybe with this verb it's not so clear that nikomu is the receiver, but sometimes simply it is this way, that a verb requires a certain case. And not only after certain verbs we use the dative case, also after certain prepositions or phrases we use the dative case. Here are some. Dzięki, thanks to. Przeciw or przeciwko, against. Wbrew, also against something. Ku, towards something. Yes, with these words we also use the dative case. For example, dzięki tobie wszystko się udało. Thanks to you, everything succeeded. Dzięki tobie wszystko się udało. Dzięki tobie wszystko się udało. Nie mam nic przeciwko temu. I have nothing against this. Nie mam nic przeciwko temu. Nie mam nic przeciwko temu. To jest wbrew prawu. This is against the law. To jest wbrew prawu. To jest wbrew prawu. And also after certain adjectives, we might use the dative case. Here are some examples. Wdzięczny, meaning grateful, and potrzebny, needed. And in some sentences, jestem wdzięczna babci i dziadkowi. I'm grateful to my grandma and grandpa. Jestem wdzięczna babci i dziadkowi. Jestem wdzięczna babci i dziadkowi. Or jesteś potrzebny rodzinie. You are needed to the family. Like your family needs you. Jesteś potrzebny rodzinie. Jesteś potrzebny rodzinie. Then we use the dative case in some special constructions. Whenever we have an impersonal construction, then in order to put a person in an impersonal sentence, the dative case comes as a help. And then we have like a subject in a sentence without a subject that normally is. That's quite interesting. For example, let me show you what I mean. The sentence jest zimno. It's cold. This is a sentence that is impersonal. No person is involved, right? Jest zimno, it's cold. It's simply cold. We describe the situation. So it's impersonal, no subject. It is simply cold. Not that I'm cold, you are cold, it's cold. That's an example of an impersonal sentence. But sometimes we want to put the person inside that. How can we put the person inside an impersonal sentence? The dative will do that trick. So if you want to say that I'm cold, I feel cold, it is cold to me, something like that, then put the person in the dative case inside. Jest mi zimno. Jest mi zimno. Like, I feel cold. So we kind of transformed the impersonal sentence into a somehow personal with the dative case. Because if you put the person as a subject, then it would be like, ja jestem zimna. I am cold. That means like my body is cold. Jestem zimna. But if you say jest mi zimno, then it's like I feel cold. Then it's my interpretation, how I feel. That's my subjective feeling. Or another example, nie wolno tego robić. It is not allowed to do this. Nie wolno tego robić. Nie wolno tego robić. This is another example of an impersonal sentence. It is not allowed. Again, it. Just we are describing in general what is not allowed. We are not specifying that you are not allowed to do this. He is not allowed. But it is not allowed. Again, no person involved. But if we want to involve a person in that, we will put the person in the dative case. For example, nie wolno psu tego robić. Nie wolno psu tego robić. It's like, it is not allowed to the dog to do this. Or the dog is not allowed to do this. So this is somehow a special form of a subject in the dative case. And one more. Chce się pić. Chce się pić. Chce się pić means one wants to drink. We, with the sentence, are not specifying who wants to drink. Often when the verb plus się comes, it might suggest that we are describing a generic situation, that someone wants to drink, one wants to drink. We are not specifying who, just in general. One wants to drink. Because it's hot. Oh, ale dzisiaj chce się pić. Today, one wants to drink. Not that I want, but in general. That's, for example, what's hidden in this sentence. But if you want to specify who wants to drink, and you will say, for example, dziecku chce się pić. Dziecku chce się pić. The child wants to drink. You could also say this with a normal subject like dziecko chce pić. Dziecko chce pić. This would more mean that the child wants to drink. The child demands, wants to drink. It's maybe a normal sentence, but if you say dziecku chce się pić, so we include also the się, it also means that the child wants to drink, but maybe it's coming more from inside. There is a desire to drink. And it's maybe more focusing on the feeling. Dziecku chce się pić. you can feel that somebody is really thirsty with that. All right, so this was when do we use the dative case. Now let's see how the words look like in this case. What are the typical endings? What else might happen on the way? Let's first look at the nouns. And first, the masculine nouns. Masculine nouns in the dative case might have different endings. For example, the most typical ending will be ovi. Ovi. For example, sin, it's a masculine word, and in the dative case it's synovi. Synovi. We put the ending ovi. Syn became synovi. Talerz, a plate, will be talerzowi. We just add the ending ovi. Stół, a table, stołowi. Here a small alternation happened. U became o. Stół, stołowi. Or mąż, a husband, will be mężowi. Here a small change happened. On became el. Mąż, mężowi. Then there is also another ending used for masculine nouns, and it's u. U. And this is not very common, only in some specific words that is good to learn by heart, so the list is not that long. And here are the words. Pan, meaning sir, and in the dative case it's panu. Pan became panu. Ojciec, father, is ojcu. Ojcu. Note the change. That yeah disappeared from the middle. Brat, brother, it's bratu. Chłopiec, a boy, chłopcu. Again, a small change in the word. Bóg, God, will be Bogu. Pies, a dog, will be psu. Kot will be kotu. Świat will be światu. So I guess these are quite common words, I would say, at least most of them. And these have the u ending. There are also still some additional that will be in this list, but maybe that's enough for this slide. And then if we look at the neuter words, here we have only one ending and it's u. For example, dziecko, meaning a child, it will be dziecku. Słońce, it will be słońcu. So we can see that for neuter it's quite simple. And then we have feminine words plus masculine words that end in a, because these will follow the feminine declension. What here will happen? Here we have also different endings. One of the endings for feminine nouns is e. And this ending will be after hard consonants added. And here I listed what kind of consonants are considered as hard. And also note that there is this apostrophe before e. It means that before e, certain alternations will happen. Mainly these will be related to softening the consonant. For example, b will become b, f will become fi, and so on. So some changes will happen. But maybe let's see on an example what I mean by all this. A feminine word, mama. Yes, mama is feminine. And what do we have here? We have the m consonant here. at the end. Well, finally it's a, but before a, it's m. M, as we can see, is listed as a hard consonant. And there also needs to be an alternation. And looking at the alternations given, m changes to mi. So we change m to mi and then add e. Ma mie. Ma mie. Or another example, tata. Tata. This is actually a masculine word but ends in a, so we also use the same declension. And what we have here is t, t, consonant before a, and t is also hard. And what happens is we add a, ta, but then remember about the alternation, t in this case changes to chi. Ta, che, ta, che. Yeah, so here we need to maybe learn what kind of alternations might happen. Maybe it's good just to have some examples. What different alternations, then this will help you to change other words that are similar. Or another example, szkoła, a school, will be szkole, szkole. W became L as the alternation, and then we put E. Szkoła, szkole. Polska, Poland, will be Polsce, Polsce, because here the alternation is K becomes C, and then comes E. Or kolega, a friend, koledze, G changed to Z. Or mężczyzna, a man, became mężczyźnie, mężczyźnie. So zn becomes zni. Here two sounds alternate. So as you can see, when putting the a at the end, we take into account that we have to have the hard consonant first, and then the hard consonant changes to another sound, as listed here. Another ending used for feminine nouns in the dative case is ë. And this is also out after certain consonants. After cydzy, czydzy, szyzy. So if you identify these consonants, then you put ë in the dative case for feminine nouns. Like kierowca, kierowca, a driver. We have c here before a. That's why we put e, kierowcy. But no alternation, at least. Here, mysz, a mouse. Sz is the consonant here, and we put e, myszy. And then the final ending used for the dative case in the feminine gender nouns will be e. And this will be used after consonants that are also listed here, that are chi, ji, ni, shi, ji, yi, l. And then we have an example, ciocia, ciocia, an aunt. We have ch here, and it will be cioci, cioci. So we have just removed the a, because the e was already there. Or pani, madam, or lady, will be pani, the same way written, because we had ni in the original word. Or Jola, that's a name, a female name. We have l here, and after l, we will also have e. That's why we have Joli, Joli. Or lekcja, a lesson, will be lekcji. I know that this is quite complex, especially for the feminine nouns, as we have three endings and we need to analyze what is the consonant at the end, and then there might be some alternations. Here the best way is to just have to do with many examples. Once you really read examples, then you will have a pattern. And whenever you find a similar word to a word from a pattern, you will follow the lead somehow. And now let's have a look at the adjectives. This will be much easier. As for masculine and neuter, those both, we have the ending emu or iemu after k or g. For example, dobry, good, will be dobremu. Wysoki, tall, will be wysokiemu. Here we have the kiemu softened. And for feminine adjectives, we will have the ending a or jej. Jej will be after k and g. Like dobra, good, will be dobrej. Wysoka will be wysokiej. And that's it. For adjectives, that's the only endings we have. And now let's summarize all these endings you can have. On this slide, you can see in a table those different endings for nouns, adjectives, in different genders. So you might take a moment now and analyze it and see some patterns. Maybe this will start to make sense for you. And also note some special forms, like what happens with kto, the word kto meaning who, in the dative case is komu. Komu, co meaning what, will be czemu, czemu, and ten and to, meaning this, will be temu, temu. So these kind of forms. Also the personal pronouns, it's good to have a look at these as, for example, the forms I, you, he, it, or she can have many forms, as you can see, like me and mnie will be for the when talking about myself. And depending if we use the short form or the long form, mnie, it depends if we want to emphasize something. So emphasized will be mnie, or after a preposition will be mnie. The same ci and tobie. One form is a short neutral form and the other one is a emphasized form or after a preposition. Then on I ono will have three forms. Mu, this is the short form. Jemu, the emphasized form. And niemu, after a preposition. And then ona will have jej, and then after a preposition nie. Now let's move to different examples with sentences where you can find words in the dative case. Try to think, why do we have the dative case here and why this or that form we used. Babcia daje wnukowi prezenty. Grandma gives presents to her grandson. Babcia daje wnukowi prezenty. Babcia daje wnukowi prezenty. Oddaj koledze pieniądze. Give the money back to your friend. Oddaj koledze pieniądze. Oddaj koledze pieniądze. Przynieś dziecku coś do jedzenia. Bring the child something to eat. Przynieś dziecku coś do jedzenia. Przynieś dziecku coś do jedzenia. Pokaż nauczycielce, co zrobiłeś. Show the teacher or show to the teacher what you did. Pokaż nauczycielce, co zrobiłeś? Pokaż nauczycielce, co zrobiłeś. Pożyczysz sąsiadowi rower? Will you lend the bike to the neighbor? Pożyczysz sąsiadowi rower? Pożyczysz sąsiadowi rower? Pomóż koleżance. Help your friend. Pomóż koleżance. Pomóż koleżance. Ufam mamie i tacie. I trust my mom and dad. Ufam mamie i tacie. Ufam mamie i tacie. Powiem szefowi prawdę. I will tell the truth to the boss. Powiem szefowi prawdę. Powiem szefowi prawdę. Życzę pani wszystkiego najlepszego. I wish you all the best, ma'am. Życzę pani wszystkiego najlepszego. Życzę pani wszystkiego najlepszego. Dzięki Bogu. Thank God. Dzięki Bogu. Dzięki Bogu. To jest lek przeciw grypie. This is a medicine against the flu. To jest lek przeciw grypie. To jest lek przeciw grypie. To jest wbrew naturze. This is against the nature. To jest wbrew naturze. To jest wbrew naturze. Jestem panu wdzięczna za pomoc. I am grateful to you for your help, sir. Jestem panu wdzięczna za pomoc. Jestem panu wdzięczna za pomoc. Pomóż biednemu. Help the poor person. Pomóż biednemu. Pomóż biednemu. Nie wierz każdemu. Don't believe everyone. Nie wierz każdemu. Nie wierz każdemu. Nie ufaj nieznajomej osobie. Don't trust a person you don't know. Nie ufaj nieznajomej osobie. Nie ufaj nieznajomej osobie. Oddaj to swojemu bratu. Give it to your brother. Give it back to your brother. Oddaj to swojemu bratu. Oddaj to swojemu bratu. Oddaj to swojej siostrze. Give it back to your sister. Oddaj to swojej siostrze. Oddaj to swojej siostrze. Dziecku chce się spać. The child wants to sleep. Dziecku chce się spać. Dziecku chce się spać. Chłopcu jest gorąco. The boy is hot, or the boy feels hot. Chłopcu jest gorąco. Chłopcu jest gorąco. Kotu nie wolno stąd wyjść. The cat cannot leave this place, or it is not allowed to the cat to leave from here. Kotu nie wolno stąd wyjść. Kotu nie wolno stąd wyjść. Czemu się przyglądasz? What are you looking at? Czemu się przyglądasz? Czemu się przyglądasz? This could also mean why you are looking at something. As czemu can mean at what is your target, but also can mean why, like dlaczego. Hmm? Komu chcesz to dać? Who do you want to give it to? Komu chcesz to dać? Komu chcesz to dać? Masz coś przeciwko temu? Do you have anything against this? Masz coś przeciwko temu? Masz coś przeciwko temu? Nie powiedz tego nikomu. Don't tell this to anyone. Nie powiedz tego nikomu. Nie powiedz tego nikomu. Pożycz mi trochę pieniędzy. Lend me some money. Pożycz mi trochę pieniędzy. Pożycz mi trochę pieniędzy. Zaufaj mi. Trust me. Zaufaj mi. Zaufaj mi. Nic mi się nie chce. I don't feel like doing anything. Nic mi się nie chce. Nic mi się nie chce. Podoba mi się to. I like this. Podoba mi się to. Podoba mi się to. Mnie się to podoba. Mnie się to podoba. I like this. Mnie się to podoba. Mnie się to podoba. Here we emphasize this mnie. Chcę ci coś powiedzieć. I want to tell you something. Chcę ci coś powiedzieć. Chcę ci coś powiedzieć. Ufam ci. I trust you. Ufam ci. Ufam ci. Wierzę ci. I believe you. Wierzę ci. Wierzę ci. Pomogę ci. I will help you. Pomogę ci. Pomogę ci. Tobie pomogę, nie jemu. I will help you, not him. Tobie pomogę, nie jemu. Kupiłam mu samochód. I bought him a car. Kupiłam mu samochód. Kupiłam mu samochód. Pożyczyłam mu pieniądze. I lent him some money. Pożyczyłam mu pieniądze. Pożyczyłam mu pieniądze. Zaufałam mu. I trusted him. Zaufałam mu. Zaufałam mu. Jemu zaufałam. I trusted him. Jemu zaufałam. Jemu zaufałam. Dlaczego jesteś przeciwko niemu? Why are you against him? Dlaczego jesteś przeciwko niemu? Dlaczego jesteś przeciwko niemu? Już jej nigdy więcej nie pomogę. I will never help her anymore. Już jej nigdy więcej nie pomogę. Już jej nigdy więcej nie pomogę. Nie wybaczę jej. I won't forgive her. Nie wybaczę jej. Nie wybaczę jej. Jej nie wybaczę. I won't forgive her. Like her, I won't forgive. Jej nie wybaczę. Jej nie wybaczę. To się jej nie spodoba. She won't like this. To się jej nie spodoba. To się jej nie spodoba. Pomyśli, że jestem przeciwko niej. She will think that I am against her. Pomyśli, że jestem przeciwko niej. Pomyśli, że jestem przeciwko niej. All right. And this is the end of the lesson with the dative case. First, you had a chance to see when do we use this case, how to transform, and then you could see also some examples with words in this case. And now I recommend to analyze different examples where you can find this the words in this case, and also try on your own to create some sentences. You can share these sentences even in the comments. This way you can use the grammar in practice. Thank you for watching and learning Polish, and see you next time.